The top story today, edtech giant Byju's today said it has filed a complaint in the New York Supreme Court to challenge the acceleration of the $1.2 billion Term Loan B and sought to disqualify investment management firm Redwood, who it alleges has conducted a series of predatory tactics. Byju's has alleged that Redwood purchased a significant portfolio of the loan while primarily trading in distressed debt with the intent of making windfall gains. It also said that it will not make any payments or interest to the Term Loan B lenders until the dispute is resolved, but remains open to discussions with Term Loan B lenders and ready and able to continue making payments under the Term Loan B if lenders withdraw their ill-conceived actions and honor the terms of the agreement. Joining us now in, is N.S. Nappinai, Supreme Court advocate, and Siddarth Pai, founding partner and CFO at 314 Capital. Also joining me is my colleague, Ritu Singh. N.S. Nappinai, Siddarth Pai, welcome to Startup Street. Let me start with you, ma'am. Explain to us what disqualification of a lender implies in legal terms and the process involved. Are there any parallels we can draw from Indian cases? Have there been any past precedents?
Oh, well, that's a pretty long question, Shruti. I'll try to keep it as short as possible. So, you know, whenever you enter into an and I'll try to keep it as non-legal as possible also in terms of simple terms and usage. So whenever you enter into an equity or a debt transaction, it always comes with many strings attached. And invariably, those strings for the lenders would be in terms of their participation or transparency in terms of management, conduct of business, usage of funds, and participation predominantly in terms of the management from an oversight perspective. So when you talk about disqualification of lenders, it actually comes twofold. The first is at the stage of investment and where it is a syndicated or a lending syndication where multiple players come to lend to a particular company. Then how it goes about it is that you will first have what are the terms that are agreed for lending an X amount of money, who is going to be lending what. But there is also a growing jurisprudence in time. This is not new. It's more than a couple of decades old, or at least definitely a decade old, where company, the target company, would then be given the opportunity to have a blacklist up front to say these are the companies which cannot form part of the lenders. And this is because it could be a competitor. It could be a company which has already lent to a competitor and therefore it will then decide to play favorites and which will jeopardize the target company's business. So when you have a disqualification process, one is through a named list and the other is through the lenders first disclosing who all are the lenders and then the target company striking down who it doesn't want to be part of the lenders list. And the third is when an acquisition is done after the lending process. And even at that stage, the blacklist would be applicable then.
Okay, Ms. Nappinai, thanks for putting that in perspective. And we'll come back to some of the points that you've made. But Siddharth, let me bring you in from an investor point of view as well. What do you make of these recent developments? You know, also in the larger context, companies being sold on the promise of India to investment companies globally, huge valuations that perhaps do not match business fundamentals. Do you think this is something that was waiting to happen? And what's the larger takeaway here?
So I think valuations are essentially a mix of business fundamentals, mix of the potential of the company, mix on macro factors, as well as investor sentiment. So I think over the years, as the valuations actually built up in certain areas, especially edtech, I think a number of investors may have actually overestimated the size of the market as well as the ability of some of these companies to actually grow into that. Now that the interest rates have actually risen across the world and the value of a dollar today differs vastly from the value of a dollar 5 years later, we didn't have the kind of paradigm because of low interest rates previously. We are now seeing an overemphasis or a greater emphasis on profitability as opposed to long-term growth. So I think the shift that's actually happened right now will take time for Indian startups to actually end up changing as part of this itself. Now, investors in these kind of securities, especially in equities, understand this as part of the equity risk that they end up actually taking. Whereas look at debt investors, which is the case that's actually of the matter over here. Debt investors actually prefer to have a stable kind of regime. They see any sort of dislocation, any sort of, I would say, transgression or perceived transgression against the fund documents, they immediately hit the exit button and they try to recall the entire thing. So I think risk appetites do actually differ. Equity investors are aware that this is another part of a cycle. Every down cycle will actually have an up cycle in some time. And the moment you have a longer duration horizon view on some of these investments, the better investments will actually end up doing well. The question is, do some of these companies that are present as of now have it in them to actually transition in this higher interest rate regime? I think that's something all of us as an ecosystem are looking at and actually studying very intently as we speak.
Oh, we all are, and this is going to set a precedent for others as well. But Ms. Nappinai, back to you. When we say a lender is disqualified, what exactly does this entail? Because the Byju statement says that Redwood is going to be restrained from exercising critical rights under the Term Loan B. What would these rights be? And, you know, is there any kind of moratorium that kicks in for Byju's even before the court approves this disqualification?
Moratorium with respect to what? If you could clarify that before I give my answer. On the
moratorium
repayment?
With respect to protecting Byju's assets, yes. You know, from the lenders not being able to take action against Byju's even before the disqualification. Yes.
See, yeah, so the first part of your question, actually, in a way, I already answered when I talked to you about the strings that come with any loan document, right? So when you're going in for a debt, you will have these various processes in terms of rights that vest with the lenders in terms of participating in a management process or overseeing a management process or confirming certain decisions by the management of a company, etc. So the disqualification in effect will take away all these rights of the disqualified lenders. And then they stand on the footing of unsecured debtors, that's all. And at best, they could then ask for a refund, and that's all there would be to it. And as far as this aspect is concerned, in terms of Shruti's earlier question, to answer the latter part of a question also on case laws, etc.
Yeah.
You have very evolved case laws and legal jurisprudence in the US in terms of disqualification of lenders and
sure.
What will be the consequences of these disqualifications.
Okay.
Though the US case laws will not have a precedent value in India, they can be used in terms of persuasive value. As far as predatory tactics are concerned, it's time and time tested, I would say. I've handled many cases and also handled transactions of similar nature. So
sure.
My word of caution would be, when you're entering into a transaction, be more cautious than you would in a marriage.
Okay.
Because
okay.
It's fine as long as it's all hunky-dory, but the minute it splits, the relationship splits, that's when every single full stop and comma in the agreement.
Absolutely, Ms. Nappinai. Absolutely. And let me quickly get in Siddharth here. Siddharth, you know, what precedent will this set for other cases? You know, in fact, we saw Ronnie Screwvala tweet today that this is selling India's name as a great investment destination and even question the fiduciary duties of the board. Your views on this?
So I think what will happen is, I think global investors are, I would say, mature enough to actually separate company-specific issues from what is actually a wider ecosystem issue itself. I don't see this as a wider ecosystem issue. The role that debt actually plays in the Indian startup ecosystem is extremely limited. I think we've actually seen another fairly large e-commerce company, e-pharmacy company, also suffer when it came to some of the debt covenants that they have, because a number of startup founders in India are more comfortable with equity as opposed to debt itself. So I think what's going to be important here is twofold. Number one, a number of boards are going to be a lot more reluctant to enter into these kind of debt financing agreements for the purchase of any business or the like itself. You're going to see a reduction in that kind of appetite to actually come in. I think the second part is going to be, a number of boards are now going to start being on an active lookout for the CFO function. A number of these issues could have actually been mitigated if a sound CFO was actually put in place to advise the board as well as the founders as to the risks that actually get entailed with some of these kind of arrangements,
okay,
as well as to model out the risk across various scenarios itself. So I think these are the two main
sure.
changes we're going to see. And investors across the world are mature enough to actually differentiate between company-specific issues as well as wider issues.
All right.
It remains good, but I think they're going to start looking at the larger companies with a fine-tooth comb when
okay.
they start out.
All right. Unfortunately, we've completely run out of time. But Siddharth and Ms. Nappinai, many thanks for joining us on Startup Street and taking us through the implications of this development at Byju's.
On that note, it is time for us to head into a short break. But